Hello, B here, and welcome back to Biology. Today we are going to start exploring the beautiful organisms that make up Kingdom Animalia. We will begin our study of animals with two lessons on invertebrates. Today's lesson will focus on four phyla of invertebrates: Porifera, Cnidaria, Annelida, Echinodermata. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to define Porifera, Cnidaria, Annelida, and Echinodermata, and identify examples using their key characteristics, to compare and contrast the characteristics of the different phyla of invertebrates, to analyze how each phyla's unique anatomy helps them survive in their environment. Before we get too far into our discussion about invertebrates, let's take a moment and review the broader category of animals. There are a lot of different ways to define an organism as an animal, so we are going to focus on the five most common. 1. Animals are multicellular heterotrophic organisms. 2. Animals typically reproduce sexually. 3. Animal cells do not have cell walls. 4. Animals have an internal digestive system. 5. Animals have the ability to move. For the last point, movement, you may be asking yourself, what about sponges? They clearly don't move. But in fact, they do! Sponges move very slowly across the sea floor, just a few millimeters a day. Maybe we should just call them the sloths of the ocean floor. Now that we know what an animal is, let's start looking at invertebrates. Invertebrates make up the largest percentage of animals. Over 90% of all animal species are invertebrates, and they represent a majority of the phyla in Kingdom Animalia. Just a reminder, in this lesson, we are going to explore four of the phyla of invertebrates: Porifera, Cnidaria, Annelida, and Echinodermata. We will look at two more phyla, Mollusca and Arthropoda, in our next lesson. While each of these phyla have distinct characteristics to help identify them, there are some characteristics that all invertebrates have in common. All invertebrates are multicellular heterotrophs. They all have soft bodies due to a lack of an endoskeleton, which is just the scientific term for an internal skeleton. Remember, the prefix endo means internal. These organisms also have a nervous system and an open circulatory system. Okay, let's start talking about sponges. Sponges are the most simplistic phyla of animals. No, I don't mean sponges to clean with, though humans did originally use animal sponges in this way. I'm talking about animals that live on the ocean floor. Sponges, the animals, lack true tissues and only have the simplest of digestive and nervous systems. The anatomy of a sponge is very simple. Their basic anatomy is the shape of a cylinder with a large central cavity called a spongocele, with a large common opening called an osculum at the top. While there could be some variety in the overall shape of a sponge and how many osculum are present, the idea of a large cavity with an opening is common to all of these organisms. The body of a sponge is made of only five types of cells. Do you know how many types of cells make up the human body? Over 200! This is another way to see how simple a sponge is compared to other organisms in the animal kingdom. The five types of cells are pinacocytes, which comprise the outermost layer and act almost like skin; choanocytes, or collar cells, that line the inner portions. They are also known as feeding cells because each contains a flagellum that traps tiny organisms as water filters through. These organisms are then moved into the amoebocyte cells to be digested. Amoebocytes ingest and digest the particles trapped by the collar cells and then transport the nutrients to other cells in the sponge. Mesohyl, which are cells of a jelly-like substance that act as an endoskeleton between the pinacocytes and the choanocytes. Finally, the last type of cell is the ostia. These cells are pores that allow water to enter the organism. The next phyla we are going to explore is cnidaria. You would know these organisms as sea anemones and jellyfish. Some main characteristics of the aquatic organisms in this phylum include tentacles or nematocytes that are used to capture food, two body layers, and radial symmetry, or symmetry around a central axis. Speaking of tentacles, did you know that the lion's mane jellyfish have tentacles up to 120 feet long? That's over 10 stories tall! Similar to sponges, the organisms in phylum Cnidaria have a simple anatomy, two tissue layers, and a gastrovascular cavity. The two tissue layers in cnidarians are an epidermis, or cells that capture food and secrete mucus, and gastrodermis, or cells that produce digestive enzymes and break up food particles. There is a jelly-like substance, the mesoglia, in between these two layers. These tissue layers surround a gastrovascular cavity that contains the digestive and circulatory system. This cavity is a single opening that acts as a mouth and is surrounded by tentacles that capture and sometimes sting their prey. Have you ever watched a jellyfish swim through the water? It's a beautiful sight. They move with such grace. And for an animal without fins, it is pretty amazing that they are some of the most efficient swimmers in the ocean. How do they do it? Well, together, the ectoderm, endoderm, and gastrovascular cavity make up what is called the bell of the jellyfish. To swim, jellyfish use the muscular tissue in the bell to expel water, which propels the organism forward. It's a beautiful and efficient way for these animals to move through the ocean. Earthworms! Ever head outside after the rain and notice a bunch of earthworms crawling in the dirt, on the sidewalk, pretty much everywhere? Ever wonder why they come out in such numbers after the rain? Well, so do scientists. There are many theories for why these organisms do this, ranging from the fact that it is easier to move on a wet surface to a lack of oxygen underground when the soil is wet. But to this day, scientists are still not 100% sure how to explain this phenomenon. But back to earthworms. Earthworms are the best example of annelids. They have the characteristic long, segmented body along with bilateral symmetry, meaning they can be divided into symmetrical sides, left and right, a well-developed brain and nervous system, and an interesting anatomy. Let's take a look at this unique anatomy now. Segmented worms, like earthworms, have a complete digestive system, meaning it is one way that begins at the mouth and ends at the anus, with other digestive organs in the middle. This digestive tract is surrounded by a coelom, which is a fluid-filled space to support the internal organs. What do you notice about all of these organisms? If you said they all show radial symmetry with five parts, you are right. All of the organisms in phylum Echinodermata are arranged in this way. However, in an interesting turn of events, this symmetry is only present in adults as their larvae always show bilateral or left and right symmetry. Other key characteristics of these aquatic organisms is a water vascular system that helps them move and calcium carbonate ossicles that form an internal skeleton. As As we went through the lesson today, we saw examples of sponges, cnidarians, annelids, and echinoderms. We discussed the key characteristics of the main invertebrate phyla and identified major anatomical features of these different animals. Invertebrates make up over 90% of all animals on Earth, and we could have spent all day talking about how cool and interesting they are, but instead, we are going to spend some time in the PDF learning more about these amazing and diverse creatures. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey, hey.